No, not when I read that, you know, it, whatever. But it doesn't really matter the context. But God uses it with me anyway. I think it was, might have been True Grit. I think it was, not Rooster Cogburn, but anyway, same sheriff, John Wayne, blah, blah, blah. But the girl, what was her name? Maddie. She was down in the rattlesnake pit. Had a broke arm. And of course, John Wayne, the hero, he shows up. Help! I'm down in this pit. I'm in a bad way. Paul was in a bad way. Outside looking in. He doesn't open his mouth in an accusation to Nero over where he's at. Because he knows and walks that, Nero, you can't do anything. Unless God allows it. Nothing. So he's beseeching believers that you walk worthy of the vocation wherewith you are called. Oh, wait a minute. I thought nothing in itself was unclean. All things are lawful. What's this emphasis on walking worthy if nothing applies? Remember, that's coming back from Romans 14. But you walk worthy with all lowliness or humbleness and gentleness with long suffering. You know, you ought to write in your Bible somewhere that the champions are the long suffering. The champions are the long suffering. Suffer long. You will suffer long. Forbearing one another in love. This Greek word forbearing here, put up with. Endure. That means you've got all degrees of spiritual walkness in a family. Now, there's a negative connotation to this word in 2 Timothy 4:3. If you want to turn over there for just a second, or turn back there to the T's. Over there. I'm confused now. Second Timothy. What did I say? Four? For the time will come when they will, there's that word, but it has a negative implication. They will not put up with. Did you catch that? They won't endure, they won't tolerate it. Are you kidding me? No. How can we have 20,000 members and we're all headed to hell in a handbasket? Because there's only two or three or four or five in the outermost branches that have chosen not to walk in lawlessness. Not to walk in wantonness, not to walk in lasciviousness, not to walk in iniquity. You see? It's the same word. So put up with, endure one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. Now, some people propagate unity at the cost of compromise. Yeah. There's nowhere that the Bible teaches that. Jesus proved that. When the Word walked here, He showed it by His actions that He did not do this. There is one body, one Spirit, even as you are called in one hope of your calling. Now here again, Paul is making reference to I, Paul, you know, you're talking about I'm baptized by Paul, I'm baptized by Cephas, I'm baptized, you know, on and on and on. No! It's one Lord. Different human hands may function to baptize you, whatever the case may be, but it's one Lord, it's one faith, it's one baptism. It's one God, the Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all. Because it's a finished work. But unto every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ. Now this is the gifts of Christ which we're fixing to transcend into that we'll see here in verse 11. There's different gifts. There's gifts that God gives, there's gifts that the Spirit gives, and there's gifts that Jesus Christ gives. They're not the same. So he's referring here to these four, verse 11, gifts. Which unto every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ. In other words, whatever in this fivefold ministry here that you're called, you're given the grace to succeed in it. Doesn't mean that you can't circumvent that power of grace because of you. Because the price has been paid, the victory's been won. It's whether you want to appropriate it by faith that it's been won. Wherever you find yourself. Wherefore he said, when he ascended up on high, when he ascended, he led captivity captive. This is speaking of when those who were in paradise, he liberated them out of paradise and took them with him. Okay? They're no longer in paradise. People still in hell. They haven't been liberated yet. And I guarantee you, when formal judgment comes and you're sentenced to the lake of fire, you'll want to go back to hell. That's how bad the lake of fire is going to be. Because see, your degree of judgment has not happened. You're in a holding hole. But paradise for the believers, the saints then have been liberated. Wherefore he said, when he ascended up on high, he led captivity captive and gave gifts unto men. See, until Jesus Christ left this planet, went back, the Holy Spirit came, that didn't happen. See, before they were disciples.
Then they were apostles.
Hello. Now, I know some of you last week, you got, well, might have got disturbed as to why I was righteously angry over your inability to explain when something happened. And Anthony shared with me this week testimony about, wasn't initially because he was in a quandary to start with too. I'm not going to put words in your mouth, but yeah, I think that's what you told me. And but I'll just let him share for a quick minute about what it was that the Spirit of God spoke to him and all that.
Well, like you said, it was like, why in the world are you so mad?
that we're 50 days off whenever she said something about Christ dying. You know, at that point, it was when the church started, and it was at Pentecost when it started, officially. Church age, it's church age. What? 50 days over 2,000 years. Whoop-de-doo. But what I wrote down was missing the mark just a little is still missing the mark. And what is missing the mark?
Sin.
That's why I was getting so mad about it. It was sin, in effect. So that I was just like, wow. Now I can see why he got so mad and why the Spirit was getting so mad, because we missed.
Yep.
Yeah, Lot's wife just missed it a little.
She turned and looked.
Well, they all hesitated. They all had to be dragged out of the city. None of them were.
Let's go.
Really wanting them.
Now that he ascended, what is it but he who also descended first into the lower parts of the earth? He who descended is the same also who ascended up far above all heavens, that he might fill all things. And he gave. Here is reference back to this gift of grace, this gifts unto all men. He gave some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors, some teachers, for the perfecting of the saints, for bringing saints into full maturity. Full maturity, not partial, full. That's this word used. Growing you up. That's these individuals' purpose, but it's been apostatized today. That's why the exhortation in other scriptures, they have a form of godliness, but they deny the power from such turn away. You don't turn away from the mentality of those teachers, it will destroy you. That's radical.
Totally.
What's unifying about that?
But our unity is not to be with darkness.
Endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit.
Right.
Hello. Not a people. You're not going to be in unity with a fleshly believer. Spirit and flesh has nothing in common. Not ever, not any time, not any shape, nor fashion. That's why households to where one spouse is farther down the road than another, there's always just this war going on. Why? Because it's flesh and spirit. How do I know that? For the perfecting. For the work of ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. See, you want to edify the body of Christ? You walk in grace. You walk in victory. You walk in power. You walk in revelation. You walk in this overcoming life, not in this defeated mode mindset. You don't want to believe that there is a second work of the Holy Spirit after salvation? Fine. You're not going to get this power of overcoming. You're going to live a life of defeat with little victories here and there. You cannot deny, you can deny it, but Scripture is evidence. That's why Acts is there. Shows what happened. Believers who were believed after Pentecost, but they had not received the second work of the Spirit. And yes, but you got some denominations now. Well, if you got the second work, you speak in tongues. The Bible doesn't say that. To some is given. Others got this. Others got... It can happen, but it's not a prerequisite. But what is a prerequisite is that if that truly has happened to you, your life is going to manifest that power of walking in victory. It's going to be in your speech. It's going to be in everywhere, every place that you go. You can't deny it. I mean, it's there. You can't hide it, guys. You can tell yourself all you want you're filled with the Spirit of God, but your life is evident of that. No amount of Bible study is going to get it done. Edifying of the body of Christ. Until we all come in the unity of the faith. Until we all come of the knowledge of the Son of God. Until we all come unto the perfect, completely matured man. Until we all come to the full measure to where we look and walk and talk just like Christ. You want to believe you're always going to sin? No. Jesus came because we're just going to sin. And he dies in my place. That's it. How do you fulfill that then? See, this is the purpose of the true apostle, prophet, even an evangelist will speak forth the true grace mystery message. But they will have had to have heard it from who? A true apostle or prophet. Paul said, I was given the message to spread it. And understand, he came on board long after Peter and John and all the rest of them. It wasn't given to them. They had to listen to the one who was previously killing folks that they knew. Get your mind wrapped around that. How would you react? You sit in here and receiving... For me, I guess y'all got your own motivation as to why you're here. But the rest of the disciples had to listen to what changed mankind from a guy who was previously killing them. Wow. This was hard on both parts. Think about that. Somebody come and drag one of your children out of the house and kills them. And then a little bit later, they want to come to you with a grace message. Hello? It ain't no wonder God, he got his finger and just ready to puke. Where we have gotten to. But see, I'm not pointing to him. I'm pointing to the one who used to sit in that chair. Won't put up with it. Nah, I'm going back fishing. I gotta go back to what I'm comfortable with. I just can't deal with this. And he goes on to say in 14, that we henceforth be no more children. Be no more babies, snot running out your nose and somebody having to wipe your hiney. Here, blow, get it all out now. Shoo nasty. Well, I thought you just read to be gentle. That is gentle. If you wanted to know what I really wanted to say, don't be babies anymore. Toss this way and toss that way. And carry. Oh, well, here's a good doctrine. Yeah, I like that one. How is it somebody can confess out of their own mouth, I've learned more under listening to you expound the Word of God than I've learned all my life, and walk away? How does that happen? If we say that we have fellowship with Him, Christ, and we walk in darkness, we lie, and we don't do the truth. If we say that we have fellowship, there's that word. If we say we're connected with Jesus Christ, and we continue to walk in darkness, we lie and do not the truth. But if we walk in the light as He is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. And the blood of Jesus Christ, His Son, cleanses us from all sin. How do you have fellowship with other believers and walk in unity? Walking in the light. Walking in the light. Not in some man-made doctrine. And he goes on to say, and hereby we do know that we know Jesus if we keep His commandments.
That's John.
He who says, I know Him and keeps not His commandments is a liar. Man, John just was in this. What happened to gentleness? He's calling believers liars. And the truth is not in him. But whosoever keeps his word in him, verily is the love of God perfected.
It's 1 John 1.
1 John 1, chapter 1, 2, 3.
Pretty much throughout John.
Gospel John. I mean, y'all. John just lays it down. Be no more tossed to and fro. So, Satan uses who? Preachers.
Yeah.
Men.
Today, the majority of meetings everywhere are being conducted by ministers of light. Most of which are false. Why? Because they have not the doctrine of Christ. This gospel of grace. This victory where the dominion no longer applies. This mystery now is revealed. But don't be any more carried about by every wind and doctrine, by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness. Wow. Whereby they lay in wait to deceive you. See, a deceived person absolutely believes what they're saying vehemently. Somebody that just here's what it says. They'll either repent right then or they'll scoff. But your exhortation is, see the but? It's just canceling out what we just read. Not about the maturing of the saints. But you're not supposed to be like this. You speak the truth in love, wherever you find yourself. You speak the truth in love. Speaking the truth in love may grow up into him in all things. See, understand, you don't open your mouth. What did we say here earlier? Where is it?
Communicate with.
You don't open your mouth and communicate and expose the darkness with your communication. You don't advance. You go backwards. Scripture makes it very plain you don't act on what you hear by faith and start doing it, your hearing goes away. And to tell yourself, deceive yourself, when it's plainly made manifest, that's not going to happen to me. You just put yourself above the throne of God. That's a fact. Speak the truth in love that you may grow up into him in all things. Proper spiritual growth requires proper faith. Because which Christ is the head, from whom the whole body, fitly joined together and compacted by that which every joint supplies. In other words, these fivefold ministry joints requires all of them to create a unified temple. Why is that? Because you can have a qualified apostle, prophet, but then whatever, a teacher, evangelist, a pastor comes in to a congregation of sheep and they have not this doctrine, what happens? You follow me? According to the effectual working in the measure of every part, making increase of the body unto the edifying of itself in agape. In agape. In agape. So it edifies itself. That's how. This I say, therefore, and testify in the Lord that you henceforth, from this day forward, walk not as other Gentiles walk in the vanity of their mind, having the understanding darkened, being alienated from the life of God through the ignorance that is in them because of the blindness of their heart. These people here is just two of a myriad of people in the church that gives you license to just keep on sinning. Yeah, right here. It's right here. Who being past feeling have given themselves over unto, there's the word again, lasciviousness. I don't know how your translation has translated it. Wantonness, iniquity, lawlessness.
Indecency.
Giving themselves over to it. In other words, it's a complete surrender to the evil. A complete surrender to the evil.
Because of the hardness of their heart.
They take pleasure in it and those who do it with them. Take pleasure. Who being past feeling have given themselves. This is not the will of God. It's a path they chose. Over to lasciviousness to work all uncleanness, interesting with greediness. It's not only working lawlessness or all uncleanness, but they're doing it with well,
or
in the effect of what the spirit of greed does to you, they're applying that to the getting and the doing of this. And you know how thirsty a greedy person can be and act. Well, that's how these people, you know, if you'd read the blog and all of this stuff here, man, these people were thirsty. They were adamant in the name of Jesus. But you have not so learned Christ. All right? Because the grace of Jesus Christ saves you from sin, not in sin. He delivers you out of it. Out of it. Out of it. And he goes on, but you have not so learned Christ. If so be that you have truly heard him. See, your life is going to manifest you have truly heard him. Because you're walking in this gospel of grace. Your life is manifesting it daily. If so be that you have heard him and have been taught by him, as the truth is in Jesus. Truth is not only in Jesus, truth is Jesus. Now, here we go to where it goes back to Romans 14. Nothing unclean. Is that what's being said? Then why this? That you put off concerning the formal conversation or concerning your former way of life. What was that? The old man. The old man, the one that did all of these things daily and had no power to stop. None. You couldn't. Which is corrupt according to the deceitful lust. And be renewed in the spirit of your mind. Spirit of your mind. Not your intellect only. It's through your intellect that you can read the word and. So intellect is not a bad thing, but your intellect will not save you. Neither will it, because you read something in here that you can walk in it or have any understanding as to what it's saying. Be renewed in the spirit of your mind, and that you put, that you put on the, wait a minute, what is it? I've always heard all of my life Jesus paid it all. Could that be another thing that, is that what's really being said? No man knows the hour of the day. Nothing in itself is unclean. Nothing is unlawful to me. That you put on the new man. See, before grace, before Calvary, guess what? Couldn't do it. That's why you had to go back and get another dove or pigeon or lamb or goat. Take it to the priest. Get it covered. Couldn't do it. Couldn't do it. So you're to do, put on the new man through Christ, which after God is created in righteousness and true set apartness. So you can't be set apart without the Spirit of God. Can't do it. You're going to get tossed to and fro. Everything's just going to blow you around like the wind blowing a leaf nowadays in this season. You won't stand. You'll waffle, you'll waver, you won't be at peace. You lay down at night, but you can't sleep. Now, if everything, there's nothing unclean, why do we have to put away lying? Maybe because the Ten Commandments, the moral law of God says, hello. Speak every man the truth with his neighbor. See? That includes me to you. That includes you to somebody else. It don't matter what they're going to call you, what they're going to say to you. You speak the truth. These people, I, without even knowing, these people are under the deception of this turning the grace of God into lasciviousness. It just don't matter what I do. We are members one of another. See, if you are a true member of the body of Christ, you will do this. And you'll find out right quick, even if you don't know the person, whether they're a true member of the body of Christ. Now see, I know it was made reference about me being mad, and I wasn't mad. Mad constitutes sin. Be angry and sin not. Let not the sun go down upon your wrath. Wrath, this is not a connotation here to wrath and anger, wrath and sin. See, a lot of times in reading this book without the Spirit of God teaching you, it's like a text message. You can't read no emotion in the text message. It's just words. He's not ruled by his emotions. So you'll read places in the text to where Jesus says, "Have I been so long with you that you are still without faith?" Or did he say, "Have I been so long with you that you still don't get it?" Being angry and sin not. He's angry over their religious deception still of themselves. Follow me? Be angry, but don't sin in the angry. But that's why you've got the modern church now. There's a sect in the modern church. You angry over anything, that's sin. Because the Bible says that a quiet word turns away wrath. So you're not ever to raise your voice. I've heard them with my own ears, guys. Leaders. Indoctrinating people. So when a true apostle or prophet or somebody of such comes along and they're painted in a totally different canvas than what they've been used to, oh, I remember that pastor telling me, I don't need to pay no attention to them. See? All the churches where God sent me, there was always two or three that would come out of the woodwork. They came to me. I didn't seek them out. And it was always in off-the-side private conversations. Reject no words of rebuke or exhortation at all. They were upset with the leadership that would shut it down. But see, with that said, years ago where we were at, and one of the individuals that was in that Bible study now posts a picture of his newborn baby in a pea suit saying "Happy Halloween." Totally without excuse. Totally without excuse. Even so much as the one when the pastor shut down the Bible study, they hunted me down in the Smoky Mountains. Not so now. What happened? How sad. Come out of her, my people, lest you be a partaker of her plagues. Come out. Come out. Come out, come out, come out, come out. These are past feeling. They've given themselves over to this lawlessness way of walking. To work all uncleanness and greediness, but you have not so learned Christ. If so be, you've heard him and have been taught by him. As the truth is in Jesus that you put off concerning your former life, the old man, corrupt according to the deceitful lusts. Be renewed in the spirit of your mind, and that you put on the new man, which after God is created in righteousness and true holiness. Therefore put away lying. Speak every man truth with his neighbor, for we are members one of another. Be angry and sin not. Let not the sun go down on your wrath. Neither give place to the devil. Jesus paid it all. It's finished work. You will either give place to the devil or you won't. That's in your camp. And anywhere that you give place, he will eat you up. You'll never have peace. You'll always be looking for a golden ring. Something. Paul, content in prison. Let him who stole steal no more. What's up with this? Now, wait a minute. I thought there's nothing unclean and nothing's unlawful for me anymore. Why are we talking about here's two commandments? Why are we talking about this? But rather let him labor, working with his hands, the thing which is good. Working with his hands, the thing which is good. You can be working with your hands and it's not good. Why? Because you're not in the land that the Lord your God has given you to be in. Translation, you're not where you're supposed to be. The Lord will bless you in your barns and all that you put your hand to do. In the land that the Lord God gives you. You're not in the center of His will. Your hands will not get blessed. And your barns will not be full. And that you don't have to farm to get that. You can be working a job where you're not supposed to be. It's not the land that the Lord your God gave you. You're out of His will. You gave place to the devil to manipulate your mind, to get you running around being blowed about by every wind and doctrine. You're not stable. You're not experiencing shalom, which is Jesus Christ. Let him labor, working with his hands, the thing which is good, that he may have to give to him who needs. Let no corrupt or let no Greek word faithless. Faithless. Let no. At no time should a believer's speech be faithless. No time. Somebody of the world brings it, has nothing to do with faith. The believer does what? Brings it all back to a faith statement. What is faith? Word of God. So don't let any faithless communication proceed out of your mouth. But that which is good to the use of edifying. See, it doesn't say here to that which is accepted. Why is it we've gotten to the point to where if somebody doesn't accept what we're saying, that that's not edification? That it may minister grace to the one that hears it. Hears it. Hears it. Hears it. Hears it. Go back to the parable of hearing. Hears it. And grieve not. This points right back up to the beginning of verse 29. let no faithless communication come out of your mouth. Because if you do, it grieves the Holy Spirit, because He is truth. He is faith. And for any believer that He is indwelling, it grieves him who does not speak faith. So you're not to do it. This crucified life is something. But Jesus said, my yoke is easy. What's all this dying of stuff that I got to get rid of? It's just like I'm wore out. You're wore out because of your fighting, not submitting. Grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby you are marked. Not sealed, marked. We've already talked about this word. Unto the day of redemption. Let all bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. I thought nothing was unclean. Why do I got to put all this stuff away if nothing's unclean? Why do I put all this stuff away if everything is lawful for me to do? And be ye kind one to another. See, we have talked about this kindness, gentleness before. And I remind you, I used an example then when we went over this about the doctor that when Donna was birthing Jennifer. We didn't know it at the time, but she was trying to birth a 13-pound plus baby.
Not me.
Not Donna. Somebody on the other side of the curtain, because it was all on the other side of the curtain in them days. You didn't have all these condos that you got today.
Sweets.
But the doctor had to break the baby's collarbone. Because C-sections was not epidemic in them days. In order to save the mama and the baby. That's pretty kind. But depending upon your perception of the act of kindness has to do whether you would label it harsh or unkind. See, so don't let another person judge you, which that's also in that up there that we'll get to sooner or later. Because they are probably spiritually discerned. They ain't got the spiritual sense to discern it. So flesh and spirit are going to be at war with one another. But be you kind one to another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, for as God in Christ's sake has forgiven you. Be you followers, therefore followers of God as dear children. Jesus told in that parable about the two houses, one wise, one foolish. Walk in agape, as Christ also has agape'd us. Did Christ show His love to us by what He did? So therefore, if Christ is in you, you will show your love towards somebody by what you do for them. What you do. I'm not discounting saying I love you, but I'm just saying that what carries weight with God is what you do. And has given Himself for us an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling savor. Now here we go again with all of this unlawful stuff. But fornication and all uncleanness, Covetousness, let it not be once named among you as becomes saints. Neither filthiness, nor foolish talking, nor jesting, which is not convenient, or which is out of character if you are filled with the Spirit of God. For this you know, that no whoremonger, and here we go back to Hosea and where we have been for weeks in Ephraim's whoredoms. No whoremonger, no unclean person, nor covetous man who is an idolater, has any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God. Paul is speaking to believers here, guys. So let no man deceive you, including yourself. Don't deceive yourself with vain words. In other words, trying to convince yourself something that is contrary to what is written. If you are in Christ and you know Him, you're keeping His words. You're keeping His sayings. Nothing wrong with talking to an unbeliever. They don't know Christianese. They don't know your religious yana-yanas. Do what Jesus did when He was speaking to me. Keeps my sayings. You know, well, as a believer, we keep the sayings of God. We'll see a religious pious person, they'll puff themselves up and say, no, I keep God's commandments. Understand, you're talking to a believer. They don't know anything that you're saying.
No, I understand.
So how do you be light? Well, explain what light is in terminology that they could understand, even being lost. Well, I know you don't understand this, but I'm a child of God, and as a child of God, I'm a child of light. Halloween's all about darkness. And He tells me in His sayings, I'm not to walk in darkness, but I'm to expose darkness by me walking in light. So that's what I'm doing right now, is exposing the darkness to you by what I'm telling you, that Halloween is witch's most holy day. And if it's a witch's most holy day, which is right opposite of God's thing, how can I participate in it when He tells me, don't do it? That's light. It's like, you know, in a dark room, you turn on a light bulb. It exposes what's around in the room. You know, don't get deep theology with people that don't know. Come on. You're just pious and puffed up. You just want to expound your knowledge. Remember, the greatest rebuke that Jesus ministered out was to hypocrites. It was the harshest tone and tongue to a hypocrite. You remember that. And if you're led by the Spirit of God, He'll remind you of that, and you won't sin in your speech. You'll have a thought, no, take it captive, boom, it's gone. What do I need to say? And He'll tell you. It's a pretty awesome life. Pretty awesome life. Full of all kinds of trials and tribulations, but pretty awesome life. Where were we?
Therefore, do not be partakers with them.
Well, where is that?
Verse 8, verse 7.
Let no man deceive you with vain words, because of these things comes the wrath of God upon the children of disobedience. Remember, He's talking to believe it. You're headed there. And for this generation, it's the tribulation period. Be ye not therefore partakers with them. For you were in your past life, before being born again, were in darkness. But now you are in light. In the Lord, walk as children of the light. See, if this lady wanted to do something about turning her porch light on and handing out something and to really be light, then she should have been speaking the truth in love to her neighbors. But I guarantee you, it wouldn't have been accepted. She knows that deep down. I don't want my house egged. I don't want toilet paper roll hanging from my trees in the morning. See, I saw that growing up. You didn't have to be as bold to do something like that. All you had to do is turn your lights off and your house dark. You don't give out no candy? Yeah. If you're in there, or if you're not in there, of course. See, I was sometimes once in darkness. I was one of the ones that, and God has a way of turning you. I had a bar of soap in my hand, fixing the soapy's window, and the guy come out of the porch with a shotgun. Did I ever attempt to do that again? Nope. First and last time. God has a way of delivering his own even before you even realize it, that he's got a plan. Oh, I can't believe Mr. Johnson, he was going to soak. Yeah, I was going to do it at Halloween.
Soaking, what is that?
Soaking.
Taking it, well, nowadays soap is in most parts in a squeeze bottle. You took a bar of old ivory soap or something and just rub it all over their glass windows. Makes a mess.
Usually on a car or something.
Yeah.
Bright things.
Oh, Where were we again?
For the fruit of light is in all goodness and righteousness.
For the walk as children of light, for the fruit of the Spirit is in all goodness and righteousness and truth. The Trinity there. Again. The Trinity of things in the written word of God is evidence if you're looking for it. It's all through it. Goodness, righteousness, and truth. Proving what is acceptable unto the Lord. And have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove or communicate it, expose it. For it is a shame even to speak of those things which are done of them in secret. But all things that are reproved, there's that same word from verse 11, all things that are communicated, they're communicated by being made manifest by the light.
Exposed.
Okay? This woman wanted to be light to trick-or-treaters. Don't join in the whoredom. Stand firm in the faith. Do something to make manifest the darkness. For whatever does make manifest is light. So here's the formula for turning darkness into light or exposing darkness. One way, not your oratory of long words. It is written. It's written. So yeah, it's good to take your intellect and to memorize scripture. And to get it in you. Therefore, there is nothing that the Holy Spirit can bring to your remembrance. Because it ain't in you. That's why having a translation, as long as the translation is truth and not been mistranslated, of something that's easier to memorize or easier to memorize. And believe it or not, the Holy Spirit is so smart, He can remember what translation you memorized.
Bring that into your memory.
And so this exhortation continues to the believer, wherefore he said, "Awake, you who sleeps. Arise from the dead." In other words, Christian, this apostle, with this message of grace, is doing what? Trying to stir believers up from their
slumber.
What happened in here last week?
No. It did stir you up.
Arise from the dead. And Christ will give you light. You want to choose to stay walking around with the walking dead? You don't get this. You come out and be separate, you'll get it. And that separation is not isolation. You're in the world, not of it. And yes, they need light. See then that your walk is circumspect. It's something that as you're walking, because this is a normal word for walking. As you're walking through life, as you're walking through your day, see then that, in other words, take special heed to how you're walking. But see, if you hadn't prayed anything about it, you haven't asked anything about it before you even walk out the door, and then you get waylaid. And then you want to ask, "Oh, Lord, why didn't you show that to me?" Maybe he would have liked to have. But you neither took the time or you did not ask. See, then you walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise. Goes back to, now here, the two houses. One who hears the word of God and keeps it, does it. The other one doesn't. Both of them heard the word. Redeem the time that was for then, and it was for now. Understand that this is the last days, and these days are evil. These days are days of disobedience. These days are days of apathy. These days are days of, no, I'm not going to tolerate true doctrine. Can't put it on me. They may even be courteous and listen to you, and they don't say anything. And they're a believer, and they either, next time you see them, they're doing the same thing I've always done. Mm-hmm. Just a courteous act of, I just let them ramble. Ain't got anything to do with you speaking the truth, though. listening or not listening hadn't got anything to do with it. Not at all. But heaven's listening to you and watching you. Because the days are evil. So don't be unwise. But understand what the will of the Lord is. That's a understand what the will, what, that's that bit, but do you know how much that takes up? Because if you don't, number one, you're not going to be in the land that the Lord God has given you. You're going to be like Lot over there. Boy, that valley looks greener, looks a lot better. This is kind of scruffy over here. I don't think I'll... Yes. I was saying, you, Abraham, I'm going to go over here. And remember the life of Joseph, that land changed for him, did it not? Mm-hmm. It was a progression through his life. And just like the children of Israel in the cloud representing the Spirit of God moving, they didn't know. Cloud lift, up. Time to go, cloud stop, time to stop. No nothing. Didn't get no special revelation on the move. Just like when we sold our big farm. Walked in after a trip. Time to go, Bubba. When? Now. Now. You know, I guess God was stuttering because I asked him that three times. Now. When? March sounds good. This was December. It was over and done. 90 days, that's it. 3 months, gone. 10 years of being somewhere, gone 3 months. And I guarantee you, according not to my word, but according to his word, that the days are full of change in all directions. And they'll be moving and moving quickly. You have a Bible verse for that? Yeah, knowledge will increase. That means it's going to move quickly. Are you living that?
Yep.
And the change will not end, guys, till the shofar blows. But even under the old covenant, Israel moved. And they moved when they saw the cloud move. So how much more under the new covenant and being led by the Spirit of God? Why do you have to have this big explanation? Walk as children. Walk. Start doing something. Stop playing house. Stop playing church. Stop playing good neighbor. It's not an insurance company. State Farm will not be there for you in the day of judgment. Walk as children of the light. because you are light, for the days are evil. Father, we thank you for your word. Even though at times the roll is hard to chew and digest, but your word is eternal. It's forever written in heaven. And we got a choice to walk in it or not walk in it. You walk or don't walk. So I thank you for this foundational message of grace that's over and over and over and over again duplicated throughout your written word. There's no escaping the message because it is truth. And I pray that today has ministered grace unto the hearers. And that by grace today, they receive some special new insight or revelation into you and your word. And now grant them in their hearing, because they are going to step out in faith and do it, grant them the grace to walk in. We thank you. We praise you, and we thank you for the substance of whatever is laid out on the table that we're going to eat today in Christ's name. Amen.